Welcome to our worship service. My name is Pastor Joseph Dietrich. I serve at Our Savior's Lutheran Church in Bilas, Arizona. And I pray that our worship today will be a blessing to you and to fill your hearts with faith.
In the name of God the Father, in the name of God the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit, now and forever, amen.
The first lesson comes from the book of Hosea. Chapter 3, the first 5 verses, we read, "The Lord said to me, 'Go show love to your wife again, though she is loved by another man and is an adulteress. Love her as the Lord loves the Israelites, though they turn to other gods and love the sacred raisin cakes.' So I bought her for 15 shekels of silver, and about a homer and a lethek of barley. Then I told her, 'You are to live with me many days. You must not be a prostitute or be intimate with any man. I will behave the same way towards you. For the Israelites will live many days without king or prince, without sacrifice or sacred stones, without ephod or household gods. Afterward, the Israelites will return and seek the Lord their God and David their king. They will come trembling to the Lord and to his blessings in the last days.' This is the word of our Lord.
Heavenly Father, I come to you confessing all my sins in thought and word and deed. A poor blind sinner, trusting in my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me. The good I should do, Lord, I haven't done. That which I shouldn't do, sinner that I am, I come to you confessing, trusting in my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me. For the sake of Jesus, I pray, have mercy on me.
Confessed your sins, I, as a called servant of the Lord, assure you that your sins are forgiven by Jesus Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The gospel lesson comes from the book of Luke, chapter 15, starting at verse 11. We read, "Jesus continued, 'There was a man who had two sons. The younger one said to his father, Father, give me my share of the estate. So he divided his property between them. Not long after that, the younger son got together all he had, set off for a distant country, and there squandered his wealth in wild living. After he had spent everything, there was a severe famine in that whole country, and he began to be in need. So he went and hired himself out to a citizen of that country, who sent him to his fields to feed pigs. He longed to fill his stomach with the pods that the pigs were eating, but no one gave him anything. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare? And here I am starving to death. I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants.' So he got up and went to his father. While he was still a long way off, his father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. He ran to his son, threw his arms around him, and kissed him. The son said to him, 'Father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son.' But the father said to his servants, 'Quick, bring the best robe and put it on him. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Bring the fattened calf and kill it. Let's have a feast and celebrate. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.' So they began to celebrate. Meanwhile, the older son was in the field. When he came near the house, he heard music and dancing. So he caught one of the servants and asked him what was going on. 'Your brother has come,' he replied, 'and your father has killed the fattened calf because he has him back safe and sound.' The older brother became angry and refused to go in. So his father went out and pleaded with him. But he answered his father, 'Look, all these years I have been slaving for you and never disobeyed your orders. Yet you never gave me even a young goat to celebrate with my friends. But when this son of yours, who has squandered your property with prostitutes, comes home, you kill the fattened calf for him.' 'My son,' the father said, 'you are always with me, and everything I have is yours. But we had to celebrate and be glad, because this brother of yours was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found.'" This is the word of our God.
Grace to you and peace from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We are on week 5 of our Healthy Family series of sermons. What is a healthy family? What does it look like? And so far we have seen from Scripture that a healthy family puts God first. It listens to the Lord first and foremost. Secondly, we saw that the healthy family cares for each other. Thirdly, we saw that the healthy family speaks about God and His Word, especially about Jesus' forgiveness on a daily basis, morning, evening, or on the path. Last week, we saw that a healthy family serves each other. Now today, as we wrap up our series, we see that a healthy family is filled with grace. In fact, we're going to look at a picture that the Apostle Paul paints of marriage, that marriage is filled with the love of Christ for His people and His people's honor and love for Jesus Christ, their Savior, in marriage. We'll listen to Ephesians chapter 5 as Paul explains this wonderful picture. He says, "Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, to present her to himself as a radiant church without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his own body, but they feed and care for their body, just as Christ does the church. For we are members of his body. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh. This is a profound mystery, but I'm talking about Christ and His church. However, each one of you must also love his wife as he loves himself, and the wife must respect her husband. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment, with a promise, so that it may go well with you and that you may enjoy long life on the earth. Fathers, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. The Apostle Paul paints a picture of marriage as one that's filled with the love of Christ. Why this picture? Why is this living example of the love of Christ so important? Well, just stop and think. That's how we learn just about anything, isn't it? Through an example, through a picture. If you want to learn how to ride horse or cook or weld metal or play sports or do just about anything, you watch people do it and then you copy it and you get better at it. And so God gives marriage filled with the love of Christ as an example for us to learn about the love of Christ and to do better at it for ourselves. And secondly, even from the beginning, God made Adam and Eve in His own image. That means the man and the woman were to be an image, a picture, a living picture of God Himself on this earth, by the way they spoke, by the way they worked, by the way they talked to each other, by everything they did, they were to be an image, a picture of God and His love. But of course we know what happened. Adam and Eve fell into sin. Sin brought death. Terrible things happened. And yet God did not leave His people without hope. He made a promise of His Son. And He finally sent His Son, Jesus. And Jesus lived for 33 years and He died on the cross for our sins. He gave His own life to save us from our sins. And so the Apostle Paul speaks of this love of Christ that saves His people as living and breathing example in marriage. And what a beautiful example it is for us to grow in faith and to live filled with grace, loving Christ our Savior and loving each other as Christ has loved us. Let's look at this picture that Paul paints. First of all, he says, wives, submit yourselves to your husbands as you do to the Lord. Wow, that sounds different in our modern culture, but notice that Paul says, wives, she submits herself freely, willingly. She's not forced. The man is not standing there saying, you better obey me, you better do this for me. No, it's fully and freely given. How so? Why would she fully and freely submit herself to her husband when she might be smarter, she might be more talented? It's because of the one speaking these words. It's Jesus, her Lord and Savior, who gave His life for her sins. And He's saying to her, you can trust me. Submit yourself to your husband as to the Lord, and I will be with you. And so it's a matter of faith and trust that she submits herself to honor her Savior who has given His life for her. And then, now Paul talks to the men. He says, husbands, love your wives, just as Christ loved the church and gave Himself up for her to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to Himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one ever hated his body, but they feed and care for their own body, just as Christ does the church. Notice how here the love of Christ is put into action by the husband. He is to love his wife as Christ has loved the church, to make her holy and pleasing, to do all that he can, even being willing to give his life up for her as Christ gave his life for the church. How can a man do this? A man can only understand this kind of love if he himself knows the love of Christ for him and how much Christ has loved him. And now he can understand how to love others. And so we see in this picture of the Apostle Paul a beautiful living example of how God's love in Christ is to be lived and seen and practiced between husband and wife. The husband is to love his wife as Christ has loved the church. She is to honor him and serve, love him as Christ, as the church loves Christ. And they do this both in humility and faith. Humility, yes, because they both realize they are still sinners and they need God's forgiveness and words of grace and every day. In faith, they both trust in Jesus who has given his life for them. They do this because they love and they trust Jesus. Now we know that no marriage is perfect. Every marriage has problems at times, but I can guarantee you this, if husband and wife practice this love, filled with love, the husband loves his wife as Christ loved the church, and she honors him as the church, as the church honors Christ, I can guarantee you their marriage and their family will be happier and more blessed. It won't be perfect, but you have the perfect Savior living for you and promising you his forgiveness and his salvation. Now Paul goes on to the children. He says, children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Notice how the Apostle Paul says that children are to obey their parents in the Lord. That means he wants children to understand that their parents are there in as representatives of the Lord. It's the Lord himself who gave these children their parents. So children were to obey their parents in the Lord. In the same way, parents are to regard their children as gifts of God from the Lord. Psalm 127 verse 3 says, sons are a heritage from the Lord, children a gift from him. And so the parents, understanding that children are a gift from the Lord, are to bring their children up in the training and instruction of the Lord. For they really belong to the Lord, and one day they will go back to the Lord. And the most important thing that a parent needs to know is that when the children go back to the Lord, they need to have faith and trust in Jesus, their Savior. It is the most important job in the world, being a parent, bringing them up in the training and instruction of the Lord, because Jesus says, whoever believes in me shall be saved, but whoever does not believe will be condemned. So our goal as parents is to plant the seeds of faith in our children's hearts deeply by bringing them up in the training and instruction of the Lord, with the love of Christ filling that instruction. Now maybe you're saying, isn't this why the church has Christian schools? Isn't it why we have Sunday school or confirmation class? Yes, the church has classes for children to teach them. But really this training and instruction in the Lord belongs first to the parents. And fathers, those fathers who are listening to this message, I pray that you take this to heart and you spend time with your children in the Word of God, encouraging them to walk with Jesus, their Savior, giving them hope in the forgiveness that Jesus gives to all sinners, and encouraging them with life that is promised by God. My friends, may our marriages and families be filled full with the grace and the love of God. And may our marriages and our families be living and breathing examples of the love of Christ coming to us through forgiveness and the love of the church going back to Christ with joy and with faith. May God bless our families with true faith in Christ, and with ears that hear his word, and with hearts that believe. Amen. And we pray, Heavenly Father, be with our families these days. There are many temptations, many troubles that strike at our families. Fill our families with the love of Christ who died for our sins, and fill us with faith that honors Christ and listens to his word with all our heart, soul, and mind. Forgive us, strengthen us, guide us as your children on this earth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Big echo it nanpa e had anti go danoa njohita wa e biga bi ai lahinde hipa.
Receive with believing hearts the blessing of our God. Bike ga adan bichagashibiya gajoldalesh. Nikaji itin gladdalesh. Bishko chapa inaka tadalesh. Shahishtego nidadit zedalesh. Gajolay.